I think we are about to start now. So it's my pleasure to welcome you back to the One World Signal Processing Seminars. Today we are we have the last seminar of this fall series. And last but not least, we are featuring a talk by Professor Pierluigi Dagotti from Imperial College in London. The talk today is an IEEE Distinguished Lecture organized by the German chapter of the IEEE Signal Processing Society. And I would like to express special thanks to Professor Gerhard Enzner and Professor Wolfgang Utschik from the German chapter of the IEEE Signal Processing Society for the support and the technical co-sponsorship of this event. Let me just briefly introduce our speaker of today. Pierluigi Dagotti is a professor of signal processing in electrical and electronic engineering department at Imperial College in London. He's a fellow of the IEEE and he received a laureate degree from Federico II University of Naples and both master and PhD degree from EPFL. He has held several visiting positions, all at prominent places, Stanford University, Bell Labs, MIT, and Cambridge. Pierluigi was the editor-in-chief of the IEEE Transactions on Signal Processing in the term from 2018 to 2020. And as you know, this is the flagship journal of the Signal Processing Society. He was a technical co-chair of the European Signal Processing Conference, ZIPCO, in 2012 in Bucharest. And he was associate editor of the IEEE Transactions on Image Processing. He also served in several technical committees of the IEEE. And in 2011, he was awarded the prestigious ERC Starting Vested Award. His research interests include sampling theory, wavelet theory and its applications, computational imaging, and sparsity-driven signal processing. Today, he will speak about new sparse sampling methods, time-based sampling, and sampling at long trajectories. Before handing over to Pierluigi for his talk, let me briefly remind you to mute your microphones, and if you have questions during the talk, please write them into the chat and we will have them addressed at the end of the talk. So please join me in welcoming Pierluigi. So, Pierre?
Sound on, please.
Ah, yeah. So you're Yeah, you're still muted.
Sorry. Yes. Can you hear me now? Yes, sorry, I was muted. Okay. I think you can hear me, right? Yes. Okay. So, Marius, thanks a lot for the very kind introduction and for giving me the opportunity to give this talk at this prestigious seminar series. My talk would be about the work I've been doing over the last decade or so in the area of sampling and sparse sampling. And this is obviously joint work. Sorry, let me make sure that, yes, joint work with several colleagues of mine, in particular Thierry Blue from Chinese University of Hong Kong, Martin Vetterli from EPFL, and Simon Schulz, who is a neuroscientist from Imperial College. And obviously, it is also the result of work of several students of mine. I don't know why not. Yes, sorry, I was having some problem with the slides. I think it's fine now. Yes. Okay, so the first point I want to make is that the sampling process, which is really the bridge between the physical world and computation, the digital world, is actually way more important now than ever because of the emergence of many more sophisticated sensing and imaging techniques that call for a complete way of rethinking the acquisition process and also really raise new questions from a sampling point of view. And so let me make a few examples to give you an idea of the challenges that I think we face, both from a theoretical as well as a technical point of view. So the first example is typical in microscopy, where we've seen a lot of progress in in the development of these microscopes. And so a type of microscopy I'm particularly interested in is known as multiphoton microscopy, and it is used, for example, to analyze the activity of neurons in the brain to try and understand how the brain encode information. And the typical type of data that you would get in that case is shown here. And when you see this spot becoming brighter, these are actually neurons. And when a neuron is active, it generates a pulse, which is known as action potential. And information is encoded through the generation, the transmission of these pulses. And so this is really what neuroscientists want to monitor and understand. Now, if you focus on a single neuron and look at the signal over time, then you'll see a signal that looks like the one shown here, which is actually a stream of pulses, even though it's a very noisy stream of pulses. The problem of these techniques is that they give you very high resolution in space, as you can see here, but unfortunately they lack resolution in time because these techniques are based on scanning the region of interest with a laser, and so illuminating in a raster scanning fashion the sample of interest. And as a consequence of that, you end up having very low resolution in time. And so a fundamental issue is to increase that resolution so that you can work out when neurons were active at very high resolution. A second problem which appears in microscopy is in the case of electron microscopy, or in particular what is known as cryogenic electron microscopy, cryo-EM, which is a technique which allows us to see, for example, the structures of molecules. And the way this is achieved is by putting several samples of let's say, the virus of interest, for example, in a liquid which is then frozen. And then you take an image of this 3D volume, okay? So what you see is essentially a projection of the 3D volume, a little bit as shown here. And so each of these objects here is a molecule, is a different one. Sorry, it's the same type of, for example, virus, but obviously since this is a projection from a 3D volume, what you're seeing here are different projection of this 3D shape. And so obviously with all these projections, in theory, you could sort of do the equivalent of back projection that you would do in computed tomography to reconstruct the 3D shape. The difficulty here is that you do not know the angle of the projection, because remember that this is an image taken of a volume where all these samples are located somewhere in the volume. And so you do not know how they are rotated. And therefore, when you see the projection, you know that these are 2D projections of the same 3D shape, but you do not know the angle of the projection. So here you are faced with a problem of reconstructing a signal from measurements taken in some sense at unknown locations. In this case, these are unknown projections. And so that creates a much more complicated problem because you have measurements, but you do not know precisely where they are coming from. And so the reconstruction becomes way more challenging. But my fundamental point is that this abstraction of this problem is actually common to many applications, and I'll show you another application soon. And so it's a context where you have access to measurements, but you do not know where they are coming from. So they are at unknown locations. And so you are faced with the problem of reconstructing your signal of interest and at the same time retrieving, in some sense, the location from where the samples were taken. And in fact, this can happen, for example, in the case of, in the case of sensor networks. So sensor networks are used very often to monitor a certain environment. So to get the distribution of a certain phenomenon, for example, could be temperature fields, or could be, for example, to localize and monitor the dispersion of biochemical agents. This is all regulated by the same type of physical laws, which is known as the, which is regulated by the diffusion equation. But normally what happens is that if you want to do that, very often you may use, for example, a sort of drone or an autonomous vehicle, which is then flying in the region of interest and taking measurements. Now, the issue here is that, first of all, when you take measurements, it is very likely that measurements are taken along a trajectory, as shown here. So you have a very high density of measurements along a trajectory, but you don't have much measurements outside that, okay? So the measurements you have are extremely extremely non-uniform locations. But the other important thing is that you might not have access to the locations of the drone. Maybe the GPS in this region is not working, And consequently, again, you have a set of measurements and you want to estimate the environment based on these measurements, but you do not know the location of the measurements. So here you have, you are facing a problem which is similar from, let's say, a more abstract point of view to the problem I mentioned here, because in both cases, even though the structure of the problem is very different, but in both cases, you're trying to reconstruct a phenomenon from samples taken at unknown location. The last challenge I want to highlight is the fact that very often we want to be able to sample very quickly, so to have low latency. And the way we achieve that currently, normally, is by increasing the sampling rate at the end of the day. And that's is an extremely energy inefficient way to solve the problem, because that means that, for example, if you're trying to create a super fast camera, you end up producing a huge number of frames. And very often these frames actually are not necessary, because maybe the fast events happen only at a certain time and then there is nothing quick happening. And therefore you end up being extremely energy inefficient, but also obviously the cost of cameras which can sample at very high rate increases very quickly, and there is also a limitation of what the hardware can achieve. And so that calls for thinking of a completely different way of doing sampling, and our idea is to try and use inspiration from nature and biology to perform sampling with low latency, but also in a very energy efficient way. So that gives you an overview of, let's say, important examples of technologies which are used to sense phenomena of interest, but also of the type of challenges that we are faced. On the one end, we also strive to higher resolutions. We are faced with problem of finding energy efficient way to sample, and then often we sample at unknown locations. So this set of considerations then sort of naturally lead to the outline of this talk, where I will start by stating, I would say, the traditional standard sampling problem, and then highlight some results which are now a little bit more traditional, in particular in the context of compressive sensing and sparse sampling. And I'm going to use that as a sort of starting point. So we can going to use some of the ideas that we developed in the area of sparse sampling, and we're going to use them to try and address some of these more contemporary questions. And so I'll talk about some form of bio-inspired sampling, which is really a sampling based on storing information in the timing of the samples rather than in the amplitude. And this is normally achieved using systems which are known as integrated fire systems, or sometimes they are also called time encoding machines. And they really mimic the way in which neurons operate. So neurons in the sensory system fire when there is something important happening. And the timing of the spike is really where most of the information is encapsulated. So we're going to analyze this type of alternative form of sampling. And then I'm going to discuss about sampling at unknown positions, and in particular, the problem of sampling along trajectories which are unknown. Okay, so the problem of estimating physical fields using mobile sensors that move along a trajectory which might be unknown. And then I will briefly mention this problem of reconstructing from projections taken from unknown angles. Okay. Sorry, I don't know why I struggled to move my slides. Okay, I hope this is fine now. Okay, so let me start first of all with the standard sampling setup. So in the traditional setup, we have a signal is continuous time or continuous space, which is observed by an acquisition device, which we normally simplify and assume it behaves like a filter. So it is a filter with a certain unit impulse response H. So the acquisition device introduces a certain distortion, and then the distorted signal is sampled typically uniformly, leading to our measurements YN. And now if we really look at this process step by step, we realize that if I introduce a new function phi, which is essentially a time reverse version of the unit impulse response, and I call this function the sampling kernel, then the measurements I have access to can be seen as the inner product between the incoming signal x and shifted versions of my sampling kernel phi. And the shifts are uniform and depends on the sampling period. So the fundamental questions in sampling is to understand when there is a one-to-one mapping between the samples y and your signal x. and which type of devices you can use that can give you a one-to-one mapping. And finally, if you found a one-to-one mapping, how can you reconstruct X from Y? In the typical setting, okay, so in the traditional setting, we constrain the type of signals that we consider, and the typical signals that are considered in the traditional, let's say, sampling context are signals that are described by a single prototype function phi and its uniform shift. Okay, so X is a linear combination of phi and its uniform shift. These signals are said to belong to shift invariant spaces. And the typical example of signals that lie in the shift invariant spaces are band limited functions. So if phi is a sync function, then X is a band limited function. So under this model for the signal X, then the sampling and reconstruction process are actually linear. Given the samples that are obtained using the system that I mentioned before, you reconstruct using a linear filter. The shape of the filter phi is exactly the shape of this function that generate the classes of signal X that you are considering. And again, if phi is the sync function, this is the ideal low-pass filter, and also the filter here will be the ideal low-pass filter, and we are back to the traditional sampling result. But obviously, you can extend this by taking alternative function phi here, and the typical case is that you consider splines as function phi here, and so that you can reconstruct functions X, which are essentially piecewise smooth functions. The problem of this approach is that the classes of signals that you can sample is actually relatively limited. In particular, there are no real life signals which are exactly band limited. And so that therefore raised the questions on whether we could try and model the signal in a different way. And so the intuition is that signals which might be more realistic actually can, rather than being described using this subspace type of model, can be described using the idea of sparsity. Okay, so the intuition is that if you have a signal which is, for example, a stream of pulses like the one shown here, if you know the shape of the pulse, if you have this prior, then really this signal is completely determined by only the location and the amplitude of the pulses. Okay, and so it's sparsely described because there are only a small number of parameters that can describe this type of signal. And so this type of modeling then led to you know, the advent of this sparse sampling theory and of compressive sensing. In the standard compressed sensing type of formulations, the problem is actually discretized. So you discretize X and you convert it into a very long vector. And the idea that the X is sparse means that in its simplest form, X is a vector with only a small number of non-zero entries, okay? Then the acquisition process is still linear since it has been discretized. Then the filtering here is converted into a matrix. And then what you observe are the samples that you model as a vector, which is now much shorter than X. Now, by using the strong prior that X is sparse, then you can try and reconstruct X from Y using, for example, convex optimization strategies. So by using the L1 minimization strategies, and about 15 years ago, some strong recovery guarantees were proved by Donohoe, Candace, and colleagues. And this is what created a lot of excitement about compressive sensing. However, as I said before, in its more traditional form, compressive sensing requires that we discretize the incoming signal to model the problem. And that is a little bit of a self-defeating type of approach because we're trying to solve a sampling problem and the incoming signal must be continuous in time or space. So therefore, in this talk, I prefer to stick with the assumption that the signal is continuous. And then the idea is that we model sparsity using a parametric type of sparsity. And so we consider classes of signals which are known as signals with finite rate of innovations, which were introduced by Vetterli, Marcelliano, and Blue about 20 years ago. And in their simplest form, a signal with finite rate of innovation is a signal which has this shape here. So phi is a known function, could be a pulse. But the fundamental point is that the location of the pulse can be anywhere on the real axis, okay? And then X is also an unknown amplitude. So this simple type of model can, representation can model signals which could be stream of pulses, phi will be the shape of the pulse. And then the unknown, as I said before, are the locations and the amplitude of the pulses. But you can also model, for example, piecewise constant signals, piecewise polynomial signals, or piecewise sinusoidal signals to make a few examples, and also classes of multidimensional signals. The key intuition here is that if I know that my signal, for example, has only k pulses, then I only need to retrieve 2 times k parameters to retrieve the signals, the signal exactly, because I just need to retrieve the location of the pulses and their amplitudes. And so the high level intuition is that, okay, if I have a sufficient number of measurements, at least let's say 2k measurements, but normally more, then probably there is a way to map these measurements to these free parameters. And so if I can then retrieve these free parameters from the samples, I can reconstruct the signal exactly. So the question is, how can we achieve that? And the basic idea here is the following, okay? So let's assume we are faced with the simplest possible stream of pulses that we can think of, which is a signal, which is a stream of k Dirac's, okay? And remember, we're trying to retrieve the locations tk and the amplitude xk of these Dirac's. And we observe our samples yn through the acquisition process that I mentioned before. So the basic idea is that we want to try and map these samples to a new set of measurements that I'm going to call SM. And we want this set of measurements to have this specific shape, okay? So we want them to be a sum of exponentials as shown here, where the exponential UK encapsulate the information of the location of the Dirac's, whereas the amplitude BK encapsulate the information about the amplitude of the Dirac's of the pulses. Why do we want to do that? Because if you are able to create, to make this mapping here, and then we have access to this sequence SM with this shape here, then we can use a standard method, which is known as the Pronis method, which has been broadly used in engineering, in particular in array signal processing, for example, to estimate the direction of arrival of a wave when you have, you know, an array of antennas. And so we want to essentially, if we can do this mapping, we can use this method. And this method automatically, in some sense, allows us to retrieve the UKs and the BKs, okay, from this set of values here. And then once I find the UKs, then I find the locations of the pulses. And then given the locations from the BK, I can find the amplitude. So that's the idea. So the idea is that I start with my samples. I need to find a way to create this mapping. Once I've created the mapping, then I just use a Pronis method, and Pronis method will produce for me the UKs and the BKs, and then I'm done, okay? This method is known as Pronis method because it was first discovered by Baron de Prony in the 18th century. So how are we going to do this mapping? So remember that we measures, okay, our measurements yn, our samples, are actually the inner product between x and the sampling kernel. And also we take uniform shift of the sampling kernel, okay? Now, the shape of the sampling kernel is assumed to be known a priori. It's something that we can estimate. Okay, you have your device, and then you estimate the distortion the device introduces. So here is an example of a sampling kernel. This is actually the distortion that we measured, which is introduced by a lens in a camera. So we had our camera and we measured that. This is known as the point spread function. But bottom line, you can have an idea of phi. You estimate that before doing your sampling. And so our idea is the following. Given phi, what we want to do, we want to take a linear combination of phi with its uniform shift. And we want to find coefficients here such that this linear combination is as close as possible to a complex exponential. So visually, this is shown here. So you have your sampling kernel here, then you take a shifted version, which is this other black line, and then you have another shifted version here, another shifted version here, and so on and so forth. And then you do a weighted sum of all these shifted versions, and you try to find the weight such that when you compute this sum, you end up with something that behaves like a complex exponential. Okay, so that's the real part, and so it's an oscillating function. And then the idea is that if I change the coefficients, I want to reproduce an exponential with a different exponent. And so maybe I want to have a slower oscillation here, okay? So the question is, given phi, how can I find these coefficients such that this condition is satisfied? And so in general, if you want, what we're planning to do is that given phi, we want to find coefficients such that this linear combination is as close as possible to a certain function of interest. And for us, being as close as possible means that we want to reduce the error in the least square sense, okay? So that really means mathematically that what we're trying to do is that if this is the function we're trying to reproduce, okay, we look at the space essentially, which is generated by phi and all its uniform shifts, all right? And then what we just need to do to find the best possible approximation in the least square sense is to compute the orthogonal projections of F over this subspace. Okay, and to find the orthogonal projections, you just can use the orthogonality principle. The orthogonality principle says that the error in my approximation, which is this vector here, okay, which is shown here, this is the error, must be orthogonal to all the elements or to all the phi. So to phi t minus one, and so on and so forth. Okay, so that leads to this set of linear equations. And then you can find the coefficients here that satisfies this equality here. And that will give you the coefficient that give you the best approximation in the least square sense. Now, in our specific instance of this problem, F is actually a complex exponential. And also remember that here we are looking at uniform shift of phi, okay? So these two facts allow us to actually find a closed form expression for these coefficients. So even though this is the general problem, if you think of F as this complex exponential, and then you use the fact that here you have uniform shift, then you discover that you can find a closed form expression. And the fundamental point I want to highlight is that the closed form expression says that this coefficient should be a discrete time version of the exponential that you want to reproduce. And the coefficients here are going to depend on the Fourier transform of your sampling kernel at the frequency that you're trying to reproduce. And that's the results due to Tony Origo and Thierry Blue. So given these coefficients, then now we can solve essentially our problem, because what we do is the following. We found these coefficients. We have our measurements yn. So we compute these weighted sums as shown here, okay? So we found the weights using the approach shown before, and then we compute these weighted sums. Remember that these weights change according to the exponential that we're trying to reproduce. So they depend on the index m, which is related to the exponential you want to reproduce. So this leads to a new set of measurements that I call sm. And now remember that the y is an inner product. And so I am replacing y with its expression. And then linearity of inner product allows me to move the sum inside the inner product. And now I have this quantity here, which by construction is very similar to our complex exponential. Okay, so if I put everything together, what I'm saying is that given the samples, I take this weighted sum, this gives me these new measurements, and these new measurements are approximately equal to this integral shown here. Okay, this applies to essentially whatever x I want to consider, but if x is a stream of Dirac's, then I can plug in the stream of Dirac's into my integral here, and so this convert the integral into the sum. And then I pick omega m, so my various exponent, to be evenly spaced. And by doing that, then this sum here is converted into the sum of exponentials that I was after. And I can then use Prony's method on this sum of exponentials to solve my problem. Let me sort of summarize the basic idea here, okay? So we have our samples yn. By knowing the sampling kernel, we have computed these weighted sums here. Okay, and this has given us this new set of measurements Sm, and through some algebraic manipulations, we have discovered that this Sm corresponds exactly to the sum of exponentials here, and the UK here encapsulate the information of the locations of the Dirac, whereas the BK encapsulate the information about the amplitude of the Dirac's. Therefore, I feed this sequence Sm to Prony's method. Prony's method produces the UKs and the BKs, and then I retrieve locations and amplitude of the Dirac's. So here is a concrete example of this basic approach in action. Here I have a stream of pulses. I know the shape of the pulse a priori. This is a pulse with a fast raise and a very slow decay. Then the black dots here are the samples that I have access to, okay? So they're obtained by filtering this guy and then sampling uniformly. I take these samples, I compute these weighted sums, that gives me the sum of exponentials, then I apply Prony's method, and then I retrieve the locations and the amplitude of the pulses, and then I can reconstruct the signal with no error. So I can have perfect reconstruction. So that gives you an idea of the standard approach of sampling. Now you can sample more complicated signals using variations of these type of ideas, but really the basic idea is what I've described before. So you start with the samples, you take linear combinations to try and reproduce exponentials, and that will give you measurements that you can then in some ways use in combination with Prony's method to retrieve the parameters that determine your signals. So let me show this in practical applications. So let me go back to the applications in neuroscience that I mentioned at the beginning of the talk. So here, remember, this is a stream of pulses. The pulse is an action potential, and we really need to work out when the action potential happen at a very high resolution. Now, this is data, it's real data, but we also acquired it in a very specific way so that we have access to the ground truth, actually, activation time. So we know when the neurons were active with very high resolution so that we can run our algorithm on this data, which is at low resolution, but then we have the ground truth information to check the performance. And so here are the results that we obtained. The blue lines are the original spikes and the red lines are the detected spikes. You can see that sometimes maybe we miss a spike, but overall we actually achieve reconstruction with very high resolution. And in fact, this approach outperforms all existing methods in the area. A second application is in imaging. So we can do the same type of ideas for images. This is a zoomed in region of a real image. This is a picture of the Victoria and Albert Museums in London. And so this is a little features of that. By applying in this type of ideas, we can enhance the resolution of this image by a factor four per direction. And this is the type of image that you obtain. But we can also use that in a context similar to the context of sensor networks. So here, this is again real data, but it's a very controlled environment. So here we have a silicon plate, and then we use a heat gun to create a very localized heat source, okay? And then we measure the diffusions of the heat over time. We do that by using a thermal camera. So we actually have a video sequence, but then we extract only a few pixels of that camera, and these, which are shown here, and this would represent the sensor that are measuring the temperature field in this region. If I look at the measurements over time, these are the type of measurements that I get from a couple of sensors, and you can see that the data is extremely noisy, but we also have a very strong prior. We are after a single very localized source. And so by running the method that we mentioned before, because of the strong sparsity of the problem, we can actually reconstruct something which is very satisfactory. So here, this side is the real data from the thermal camera, and this is what we estimate using the few measurements that I showed you before. Okay, so that gives you an idea of sparse sampling. I think sparse sampling works and can have impact in concrete applications. So we want to leverage these results to try and address other problems which involves sampling. And in particular, there are these two type of problems that I've mentioned before, which you want to solve. One problem is about sampling in a more efficient way, in particular when we are faced with the problem where we want to have some results with low latency, okay? And the other is when we sample at unknown locations, in particular when we are maybe monitoring a physical fields with a mobile sensor and we need to sample along a trajectory which is also unknown. So let me focus on the first problem. And let me try and highlight with an example why our traditional way of thinking of sampling is actually inefficient, okay? So let's assume that we're trying to solve the following problem. We want to get an estimate of the rainfall, okay, over a certain period, let's say over the summer season, okay? So it is over the summer and we want to do this small experiment and see how much rain fall, you know, from July to September. So the first simplest thing we can do is to get a bucket, put it at the back of our garden, and then measure at regular intervals how much rain fall in the bucket, okay? So we put this on the 1st of July, for example, and then after 10 days, we go and check how much rain is in there. We store that information, we empty the bucket and repeat the process. So we wait 10 more days, maybe July is a rainy month in this example. So on the 20th of July, I get the data, how much rain dropped. I store this information, I empty the bucket, and then I repeat the process. And maybe on the 30th of July, I again get a lot of rain, okay? Now, it depends on where we live. I live in London, so normally it's not that unusual to have rainy summers, but when I'm originally from southern of Italy, there is normally no rain whatsoever over the summer, okay? There is sun, you know, uninterrupted sun for 3 months, okay? So if we are in a region where there is not much rain, what happens is that maybe after July, I keep my bucket, and after 10 days, there has been no rain whatsoever. And yet I have to go check the bucket, store the information, they say no rain or maybe one drop of rain, empty the bucket, and then repeat the process, okay? And even though there is no event, so there is no rain, okay, I still have to do this at regular intervals, okay? And maybe towards the end of August, we get some rain again. So here, the approach is inefficient because if there is no event, so if there is no rain, I still have to measure regularly, okay, how much rain is in the bucket. So I still keep getting regular measurements. And if I want to increase the resolution, I would normally maybe check the bucket every 5 days or even every day. And that would be even more inefficient because during the months of August, I probably need to check this bucket 20, 30 times and just to realize that there has been no rain whatsoever. So that suggests that maybe there is a more efficient way to do something where I sort of try and record when the event happens rather than having information at regular time interval. So what I could do is the following thing. I put my bucket as usual, but then rather than checking the bucket at regular intervals, I let the bucket there and I wait for the bucket to be full. Once the bucket is full, then what I do, I write down the date of when that happened. So I write down, for example, on the 18th of July, my bucket was full. I empty the bucket and I repeat the process. So in our example, July was a rainy month, okay? Therefore, maybe after 10 days, the bucket is again full. So what I do, I write down the date, 28th of July, I empty the bucket, and then I let the bucket there until it is full again. And remember that in our example, there was no rain in August. So for the entire month of August, because there are no events, I don't have to do anything. And then maybe the next time the bucket will be full will be in September, okay? And so again, I write down the date and I empty the bucket. So what I'm doing here is what we call integrate and fire. So I integrate the information because I'm waiting for the bucket to be full. When the bucket is full, I fire. So fire means I write down the date and I empty the bucket. Right? And that's exactly what nature does, okay? So the first approach is really what we tend to do with our standard system. We sort of sample regularly and measure the amplitude of our samples. In nature, what the neuron does, they accumulate information, okay? So they integrate, and then when there is enough accumulations, then, so you pass the threshold, then you fire. So a neuron would generate an action potential, and then through that, it will sort of go back to a sort of a zero state starting point. So we'll be like emptying the bucket, okay? So we call this system integrated fire systems. And then clearly the information there is not in the amplitude because the amplitude of the sample is always the same, but it's on when you are firing, okay? So we need to find a mechanism that encapsulates information in the timing of the samples. Now, devices that can do that are now starting to appear, actually, and they're called very often neuromorphic sensing systems. So we have, for example, neuromorphic cameras, and the neuromorphic cameras are sometimes also called event-driven cameras. And the idea of these cameras, for example, is that a pixels only records when there is a variation of the light impinging on the pixel. If the variations is large enough, then the pixel fires, to use the expression that I used before. And so what you do, you store the location of the pixel that fired and the timing. And since you can store the information of the timing at very high resolution, you end up with a video sequence, which is virtually a sequence at very high frame rate, even though it is very energy efficient because you only fire when there is an event. So if you're taking a video of a static scene, nothing happens. So let me show you here the video produced by one of these event-driven cameras. This is a company in Zurich. Okay, so here is a video of a flipping coin. Okay, so this is in slow motion. Okay, this is actually a real flipping coin. And because you can have the timing information at high resolution, you actually can create the slow motion of the coin. And then you can see that essentially the only active pixels are those that are seeing a change in the scene, therefore a change in the illumination. If the change is large enough, then there is the firing. And so that is what you store. So for us, the fundamental question is, if I have access to this type of data, can I, for example, reconstruct the original intensity video? Okay, so the normal video that I would see, but at this time a resolution. Okay, so we are faced with a reconstruction question, but we're also faced with another fundamental question is, if I want to acquire the information by encapsulating it in the timing of the samples, what is the best way to do that? Okay, so how can I embed the information of a complicated signals in the timing information of these spikes? This is a fundamental question, not only from a sampling perspective, but also because if we find a good way to encapsulate the information of a signal in the time of the spikes, then this is going to lead to new neuromorphic devices. So there is a clear implication in the technology. So if we devise a new sampling strategy, this could lead to new neuromorphic sensing system and therefore to new technologies. So let's try and formalize this a bit more. Okay, so as I said, one typical example of these devices is the integrate and fire system. So you have your signal, you have an integrator here, and once the value of the integrator passes a certain threshold, you fire, okay? And then you store the timing on when you fired, and also the threshold can be positive and negative, so you have a sign information here, okay? And when you fire, then you reset your integral here. Okay, so that's the standard integrate and fire system. A simpler system that encodes information in the timing is the comparator. This is another time encoding type of machines. It's less interesting from a practical point of view, but it's sort of easier to analyze. And so I want to spend a couple of minutes on this. Here, the idea is that you have your signal, and then you have a reference signal, G, and then you compare these two guys. So essentially, you take the difference, and then you look at when the difference crosses the zero, okay? And then you store the time when the difference crosses the zero. Okay, so that's shown here. This is what you store. So these are the timing information that you store. Now, clearly, the fundamental point is that from this timing information, since you know G and you know that this is happening when X is equal to G, you actually can retrieve the amplitude information of the original signal at the times when you are firing, okay? So that indicates that from the timing of the fire, of the firing, you can work out some information of the amplitude of the original signal. This applies also in the integrate and fire context, even though the mapping is a little bit more convoluted, but essentially the fundamental point is that you can retrieve some information of the original signal. In this case, you retrieve the information of the original signal, but at non-uniform locations. And so the question is, given these non-uniform samples, can you reconstruct X? And here we can sort of leverage some results which were produced in the past on sampling, on non-uniform sampling. And one of the most fundamental results is due to Aldrubi and Grokenig. And let me give you an idea of their approach. Okay, so they came up with an iterative algorithm that they proved when it would converge. Okay, and the idea of the algorithm is the following. So if I go back to the example here, remember that we know that this bucket was empty when we started. So for example, on the 1st of July, and then was full on the 18th. Okay, so we know how much rain fall between 1st of July and the 18th of July. So what we can do is say, okay, since I know this quantity, I can assume that it rains uniformly over that interval. And so this is the amount of rain I had, okay? Then we emptied the bucket on the 18th and it was full again on the 28th. Therefore, we know how much rain dropped in these 10 days. And we can assume that it dropped uniformly during these 10 days. And then we can repeat the process, okay? So that would give us a sort of piecewise constant approximation of the signal we're trying to estimate. Now assume that we have some prior. For example, the phenomenon we're trying to estimate is band limited. So what we can do, we can project this guy on the space of band limited function, and that will give you something which is band limited. Okay, so a function that maybe looks like this. What we can do now is to check whether this sample, this signal would lead to the same measurement that we have access to. If the result is consistent, we are done. If not, what I can do, I can correct for the error, and then I repeat the process. So let me show that for an actual signal, which belongs to a specific subspace. So this is my function. I have the non-uniform samples shown here. I do the piecewise constant approximation, as I mentioned before. I project this onto the correct subspace, for example, the subspace of band-limited function. I re-estimate the samples. I check the error, and I repeat the process. So piecewise constant approximation of the error, projections of the error, and then I combine the first estimate with this correction here, and then I keep repeating the process. And if I have a sufficient density of samples, what Aldrub and Grogenig showed is that you are guaranteed to converge to the right solution. So this is a strong result from them, but there are a couple of caveats to these results, okay? The first is that in order to guarantee convergence, you need the density of samples here, which is higher than the density of sample that you would have if you were doing uniform sampling. Okay, so remember that our starting argument was that we wanted to be energy efficient. So we just want to sample when there is an event, okay? And so this result is actually, in that respect, not a good result because it is telling us that we need more samples than we would normally have. The second problem is that this applies to, let's say, signals that lies in shift invariant subspaces, like for example, band-limited functions. And these are sort of less interesting to our problem because here we're really interested in signals which can have events which are very concentrated and then there are, and that nothing happens for a while, because this is where this type of sensing strategy would be efficient. So we're really interested to sparse signal in this case, because in a sparse signal, think of it as a stream of pulses. When there is a pulse or there is an event, you want to get a lot of measurements, then you don't want to get anything when nothing is happening, okay? So this type of problem really matches well with the model of signal with finite rate of innovation or sparse signals in general, but also we need to find a different way to sample and reconstruct because this standard reconstruction strategies is not efficient. And so our idea is to try and leverage what we've learned on standard sparse sampling to try and solve the problem, okay? And remember that key in sparse sampling was the use of a proper, let's say, sampling kernel, and this idea of reproducing exponentials. And then the other key thing was the use of variations, if you want, of Pronis method. So these are the two fundamental pillars that we want to use also in this context. So this leads to a slight modifications of our acquisition system. So before having the integrations and fire system, we have a kernel here. So we have a filter, which would be our acquisition device. So our signal X is first filtered and then is integrated. Okay, now under this model, one can show that from the timing informations here, I can retrieve some measurements related to X. And in fact, they are related to the inner product between X and shifted version of a function which looks like the sampling kernel, okay? But now the shifts are non-uniform, right? The shift depends on the timing here and they are non-uniform. But in some sense, back to something very similar to what we were doing before. And therefore, what we want to do here is to try and use similar ideas as before. So we want to try and see whether we can reproduce exponential with our sampling kernel. And secondly, we want to see what is the right density of samples we need in order to be able to reproduce exponentials and then to reconstruct signals. So these constraints on the number of samples we need leads to a constraints on the trigger mark. Okay, so if I go back here, so leads to some constraints on the threshold here. We want it to be small enough so that when there is an event here, I have a sufficient number of samples so that of timing information so that I have a sufficient number of samples like here so that I can then reproduce exponentials and do the reconstructions as before. But also what I want to make sure is that nothing happens like here if there are no events. So the first good thing is that given my phi, even though I have non-uniform shifts, I can still apply the same framework as before to reproduce exponentials. The only caveats here is that because the sampling is non-uniform and phi might not be globally smooth, right? I need to concentrate my sum over very short intervals, okay? So short intervals, which happens when there is the events, because beyond that, I cannot guarantee that I can approximate exponential with good accuracy. So that's the only difference with respect to what we had before, but otherwise it's exactly the same situation as before. And so based on the sampling kernel phi here, and on these constraints that I need to have sufficient number of samples in a small interval so that I can reproduce locally my exponential, this leads to constraints on the trigger mark. And one can find precise constraints based on the shape of phi, okay? So if I go back to the simplest case, so let's say I have a stream of pulses, like a stream of Dirac's that I want to sample, then under these conditions, what I try to make sure is that after each pulse, I have immediately after it, I have three spikes which are generated. I need three spikes because I need the first one to sort of reset everything. Remember, here I have an integrator which is sort of still carrying some information about what happened before. And then I use the other two to retrieve the 2 degrees of freedom here. One is the amplitude and the other is the locations of the Dirac. Okay, so given the signal, given phi, I can find precise conditions on the trigger mark that will make sure that given a event, I produce at least three spikes immediately after the event, and then nothing happens. And then there is another event, I produce at least three spikes, and then nothing happens, and so on and so forth. So here in this example, here I have five pulses, here I have three, and here I have four. I have always at least three, and then from each of these group of spikes, I can reconstruct the pulse that preceded them. This idea can be used on other signals, for example, on piecewise constant signals. And what is interesting here is that when I am in the constant region, I'm not producing any spike. So I'm actually very energy efficient because if there is no events, there is no spike generated. So our time encoding machine is generally asynchronous because it generates a lot of spike when needed, and then there is complete silence when there is nothing happening. This can be used also for video, specific classes of videos. But what is interesting here is that each pixel is one of these time encoding machine, but pixels here behaves differently. So we need to have a slightly different, for example, trigger mark and shape of the filter here in order to be able to reconstruct. So that diversity suggests that actually these event-driven camera that have been built are maybe not optimal, okay? There might be better cameras that can be built by making sure that pixels behave in a slightly different way, because that diversity gives you more information and allows you to reconstruct with high accuracy more complicated signal. In our case, our signal is something very simple, is some specific shapes, okay, that are described with a finite number of parameters, and then this shape moves at constant speed along a certain trajectory. Based on that, we can retrieve from the samples the shape itself and then the movement and therefore the entire video. Let me just show you an example of the video that we can reconstruct exactly and of the type of data that we would get. So this is the video and we can reconstruct that exactly, so I don't need to show you the reconstruction. These are the events which are generated by that video with our obviously idealized camera, which is a different camera from the one that is commercially produced, okay? And so that gives you an idea. You're getting these, let's say, spikes, but you can see that they are slightly different from the spikes that you would get in the other case. Okay, so that gives you an idea of sampling based on timing information. And I think there are a couple of interesting things here. First of all, as I mentioned before, you derive a new sampling result that could lead to a different technology, so can have a very interesting practical impact. But also there is this idea of diversity, which appeared here, which is actually very relevant. And it's also something which is emerging for people who are trying to do learning using spike. There is a lot of research in the area of spiking neural networks. And there is some evidence that if you want to build a spiking neural network, you also want to use diversity or heterogeneity. This seems to give you robustness, you know, resiliency to in the learning. And so the ability to use your learned network also with unseen type of signals. So that's a sort of common theme which is emerging in this area. Okay, let me use my remaining 5 minutes talking about these other problems very quickly. So let me remind you that the problem here is that I would like to measure a specific physical field, for example, a diffusion field. So the diffusion field could be, again, as I mentioned before, the temperature field. But in our case, we're interested in the case in which the field is generated by localized sources. So it could be a fire, okay? And then you have your, let's say, drone flying around and taking measurements, okay? Now, the difficulty here is that we want to retrieve the physical fields, but also we do not know the trajectory, okay? So we need to retrieve also the, if you want, the location of the drone, okay? So this is a problem which is known as the problem where you're trying to simultaneously locate your drone and create a map of the environment. So it's known as LAM, simultaneously location and mapping. It's a problem which has been studied for a while in computer, in robotics, okay? In particular using images. There were famous results that appeared maybe 20 or even more than 20 years ago of this robot moving in a certain area. And then once the robot goes back to the starting point and it realizes that it's back to the starting point, then the robot is able to work out the trajectory that he did and that it did and the mapping of the environment. In our case, we want to do SLAM, but for us, we want to do SLAM when we try to estimate a specific physical field, okay? So if you're trying to estimate an acoustic field, then you would be faced with what is known as acoustic SLAM, and there is also a lot of research in that area. And in our case, we're interested in diffusion SLAM. But also, we like to model this problem as a sampling problem, but as I said before, as a sampling problem at unknown locations. Interestingly enough, the problem of sampling at unknown location has been already considered in the past. There is a paper due to Browning that appeared in TSP in 2007, where he tries to devise a method to sample band-limited signals from samples taken at unknown locations. What we can say is that this problem is extremely ill-conditioned, as you can see. It can be combinatorial in some completely unconstrained cases. Solution is not unique very often, okay? But still is a very interesting problem. It applies to SLAM in all its forms, but also applies, for example, to cryo electron microscopy, as I mentioned at the beginning. So it's actually a very relevant problem. And in our case, okay, of what we call diffusion SLAM, what is interesting is that the problem is sufficiently constrained so that we can show that we can solve it algebraically, okay? It's a, let's say, solution-based in some sense to matrix formulation. Also, the solution is unique up to a rigid rotation, which is not surprising because if I don't have any ground truth information, right, I cannot have the ground truth absolute locations of the drone, right? So there is an uncertainty, it's just a rigid rotation. So it's actually a pretty strong result, and that's due to the fact that the problem is very constrained. Let me highlight how we solve the problem. First of all, the field we're trying to reconstruct is extremely constrained. As I said before, it's a diffusion field, and it's generated by localized sources, okay? So if you have a localized source that generates your, let's say, temperature field, then the field that you're going to see has this shape here. So it's really a Gaussian. I put myself in the 2D case, so it's a 2D Gaussian. The variance of your Gaussian increases with time, okay? As shown here and is shown here, okay? And also the amplitude of your Gaussian decreases with time. So that's the type of things that you see, okay, when your diffusion fields evolve over time. We have this prior because we are trying to reconstruct physical fields. And so based on that, what we know is that if I have, for example, a couple of sources here, and I'm taking measurements along a piecewise linear trajectory as shown here, then at the single snapshot, this field is essentially made of two Gaussians, 2D Gaussians. And then what I measure along a single trajectory is a projection of these two Gaussians. So it's again a stream of two pulses as shown here, okay, which are Gaussian pulses. And then because of that, we can use, for example, FRI type of idea, so sparse sampling, to retrieve this signal on each projections and therefore to retrieve the location of these pulses. And then we can try and use that to reconstruct the original field and the trajectory. So the first message is that the problem is ill-conditioned, but it's actually very sparse, okay? There are K sources to estimate, so we need to find K locations and K amplitude. The trajectory is piecewise linear, so it's also fully determined by a small number of degrees of freedom, okay? As I mentioned before, the projections of the field on each line is a stream of pulses. And so what I can do, I can retrieve the location of each of these pulses, okay, on each trajectory. And now based on these locations, I can then algebraically retrieve all the missing information, as I'm going to show in a second. Let me say that this location here, okay, I'm going to denote as, for example, if this is related to the first line and this is related to the first source, I'm going to call it Y11, and the second source along the first line would be Y21, okay, and so on and so forth. So here, I denote with C, okay, the slope of one of the lines, okay? So C can be seen as a vector here, okay, of unit norm. It is easy to see that the information I have access to, which is YKJ, which is, remember, the locations of the projection of each pulse here, can be interpreted as the inner product between the slope of your line and the difference between the starting point of your line and the location of the source SK. So this the inner product between these two vectors will give me this green guy here, which is what we call YKJ. And remember that we have access to YKJ. We have estimated it for each trajectory, okay? So what I can do, I can create a matrix where the entry at location KJ, so omega KJ, is the difference between Y related to the same line, but two consecutive sources. Okay, so that leads to this matrix here. And because of the geometry of the problem, I can write the matrix as a product of a matrix, which is only related to the sources, and a matrix which is only related to the slopes of the lines. The matrix omega, because I'm looking at the problem in 2D, is of rank 2. And therefore, what I can do, I can factorize it using the SVD. Okay, and so given the SVD, I factorize omega into two matrices. Let me call them S and C. And then I use S to retrieve the location of the sources and C to retrieve the directions, or if you want, the slope of each line. And therefore, I can reconstruct everything. The problem is not unique because obviously this factorization is not unique. If I multiply by A and A to the minus one here, I get the same matrix omega, okay? What we can show is that this matrix A is an orthogonal matrix, must be orthogonal. And therefore, the problem does not have a unique solution, but the ambiguity is just a rigid rotation because a rigid rotation is modeled by an orthogonal matrix. If you have some ground truth information, then you can also remove this ambiguity. Okay, let me show here an example on ground truth data. So here is the same data that I showed at the beginning. So these are the samples taken along the trajectory. Different color means a different piece of the trajectory. From these measurements here, applying the method that I mentioned before, we retrieve the trajectory, okay? The estimated one is the blue one here, and we retrieve the location, which is the circle, whereas the true one is the X. So you can see that results is relatively accurate. The interesting thing is that this problem, you can model, you can use that modeling also to solve a related problem, which is the one I mentioned before. So imagine you have a certain object here and that you are measuring projections of that object. So here is one projection. Here would be the direction of a second projection. Here is the direction of a third projection, okay? And imagine that you want to reconstruct the object by doing a back projection, as in standard computed tomography. In our problem here, you do not know the direction of these projections, okay? So these are projections taken from unknown view angles, okay? This problem is very similar to the one that I just mentioned before, and so can be solved using similar type of strategies. And so here is the solution. So that is the ground truth projections and scene. We reconstruct the scene and the projection up to a rotation. So this is correct up to a rigid rotation. And if I know, for example, the ground truth angle of two of these projections, in total, I have more than three, but I'm showing only three. But if I know two of them, then I can get exact reconstruction. Okay, so that's a simplified setting similar to the setting that happens in cryo EM, and we are able to solve it. Okay, I think we've covered enough ground. Let me just conclude very quickly. First message is that sampling is doing extremely well. I recommend people to jump on the topic. There are a lot of very interesting and new questions which are really raised by the progress in technology, and something can not only help reconstructing better way, let's say, the signals that we measure with this technology, but it can also provide guidelines on how to design alternative technologies. The idea of sparsity of structures remained fundamental in something that allows us to make ill condition problem much more regular, but also remember that resolution is never enough. Okay, neuroscience is a good example. We have this abstraction where something often happens at unknown locations and can be very irregular. And also there is this emerging area of, I would say, time-based information processing, which includes the sampling bit, but also the processing element, which is an emerging area of interest, which I think we should not overlook. There are a lot of people in computational neuroscience working in that area, and I think we should definitely also embrace it. Okay, thank you very much for your time. I think I can stop here, and I'll be happy to take any question.
Oh, thank you very much for this very inspiring talk and for sharing this very interesting results with us. So there are a couple of questions. So please put your questions in the chat. There was a question earlier. So what about multidimensional signals where dimensions are not fully orthogonal? So this was in the first part of the talk.
Right. Okay. So what is, okay. So, okay. I'm not sure I understand the question, to be honest. So I guess the question is related to the case in which maybe sampling is not performed on a grid, I guess. I'm not sure, right? What is the meaning, right? Because I mean, if I think of images, I have two orthogonal dimensions, right? But obviously, we also tend to sample along a grid, so there would be a separable form of sampling, right? I guess part of the answer to this is in the example of sensor networks, right, where we have a signal which evolves in time and in space, and we have irregular samples. Okay, so in that case, we can sort of handle it. I think in general, we prefer to sample on a grid, if that was the question. When we have irregular sampling, we try to sort of move things back to a grid, to have something separable, which is easier to handle, okay? Mm-hmm. We looked at a certain point about sampling, for example, on lattices, so that you have sort of irregular samples, but I haven't explored that area very much.
Yeah, so there's a specification. So the point is, if you could use the correlation between the dimensions.
Yeah, so okay. Now, I tend not to look at this problem from a statistical point of view. So we model the signals in a certain way, and then we try, for example, to retrieve these parameters, okay? Now, the signals we consider are not separable, okay? Which would mean a little bit like they are correlated, right? And we really need to use that, in order to reconstruct them, okay? I don't like to talk in terms of correlation because we don't really create a statistical model. But if I think of it, of an image, let's say, the signals that we can reconstruct are signals where which you cannot describe by modeling the signal as the product of a function along X and a function along Y, okay? They are fully non-separable. And so in some sense, they are correlated, okay?
Okay, thank you. So there's another question. So if on September 1st, you need to estimate the total amount of rain in your example, yeah, since the last firing, is there a way to avoid checking the bucket? A priori, one can assume it is still empty.
Okay, so I suspect the question here is, what happens if I need, so I have some firing, okay, and maybe the last firing was, I don't know, late July, and then I want to estimate something before I get a new firing, okay? So it's a sort of an extrapolation problem. So that's that's a good question. So the idea of the firing is exactly that you fire immediately after an important event, okay? And so the idea would be that if your system works well, you can safely assume that after, let's say, the 28th of July, there was close to no rain. You're going to have an error, okay? But it's like saying the rain that you've seen is equivalent to something close to noise, okay? If you see what I mean, right? And if there was more rain than you expect, if there was a lot of rain on the 30th of August, you expect that you would have fired on the 1st of September, okay? So let's say that the system would work in a way that you fire and then you sort of accurately reconstruct whatever happens before. And then the fact that you are not firing tells you that what's happening in that time is something close to being insignificant, okay? You'll have an error because maybe your integrator is integrating a little bit of information, so you'll have an error, but it's essentially insignificant, is close to the, I don't know, noise level.
Okay. So then there was a question, why is there a long trail of events in the simulated spikes? I think this was in the animation.
Yes, okay, so that's a good point. So we need to make sure that we fire, so that's the difficulty when you're trying to do things extremely asynchronously, right? So you have an event, let's say, and you need to catch that event. So you need to make sure that after the events, immediately after, you have enough spikes to describe that event. And so you end up being a little bit conservative. So consequently, you end up generating maybe more than what you would need to describe that event. But the upside of that is that once you've generated this, then you do not generate anything, okay? So there is this trade-off, right, in the system. Because if you're not careful enough, there is a danger that there is an event and you do not generate enough spikes, okay? So that forces us to be sort of very conservative in the choice of the threshold. And as a consequence of that, very often we generate many spikes. That's the first thing. So the hope is that you generate a lot of spikes when there is an event, but then the next event happens after a long time. So there is a long silence. And therefore, overall, you are more efficient than a uniform sampling strategy that would give you a fixed number of spikes, okay, even when there are no events. The second point is an interesting point is, yes, we keep firing after the events in the case of the camera. And that is because of the filter that we use. And the filter is used to make sure that sort of we generate enough spikes and we are not constrained to generate them too quickly after the events, okay? So introduce a little bit of memory in the system, that further memory, if you want, that is necessary when you have a signal which has, I don't know, very localized events, okay?
Thank you. So there's a question, could you please go over non-uniform sampling with respect to boiling density, which results in non-harmonic Fourier series, Ingham theorem for observability?
Okay. That sounds like a very technical question. So I guess this is related to Aldrubi-Grokening result, I guess. So this is the result which is, what is the question here?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Let me maybe. Yeah. What was the question here? Non-uniform sampling versus Bernoulli density. Okay, which results in non-harmonic Fourier series. All right. Okay. I'm starting to go a little bit beyond my comfort zone. I think this density results is equivalent to the Bernoulli density, okay? And also it applies to non-band limited signals, okay? So the results I'm mentioning here applies to signals that belong to shift invariant spaces, and therefore could be, for example, band limited signals, but could also be non-band limited functions like splines, right? So like uniform splines. I think this density result is equivalent to the Bernoulli density, okay? But that goes a little bit beyond my knowledge. So I don't know whether you know there is something that I'm missing. I think it's the same result. I think what is, I don't know, was relevant here is also there is a specific algorithm to do that, which is this iterative algorithm, which is converging. Does that, I hope that more or less addressed the question. All these density type of results normally are, let's say, less efficient than uniform sampling. Okay, so, and that's, I think, the main point that I wanted to make here.
So I think this very technical question we can also take offline.
Yeah.
So how robust is the IF design to accumulating noise, especially when events are further apart?
Yes. Okay, that's a good question. So I don't have a clear answer at this stage. So we have simulations where we add noise. Now, remember that the integration can help in some sense with noise. We don't have, that much evidence that our method is particularly resilient to noise, okay? So that's really ongoing work. I think the focus at this stage is mostly about showing that it is possible to reconstruct, let's say, classes of non-unlimited signals, also multidimensional signals. The resiliency to noise, mismatches, et cetera, is something that we are still working on, okay?
Okay. Thank you. So there's one question. Can the sparse sampling apply to audio signal processing? For example, can we imagine to process a 96 kilohertz stream at lower sampling rate, thus processing power?
Yes. I have never worked with audio signals. I don't know. We have applied sparse sampling on real life problems, which are those that I mentioned, in the context of neuroscience, but also for images, and we get satisfactory results. It depends on how closely you can model your signal with something that is, let's say, sparse, okay? If you can, then you might be able to obviously sample and reconstruct at a lower rate, okay? I'm not familiar with many results of sparse sampling in the context of acoustic, okay? So it might not be easy. Okay.
Yeah. Then there's a question: can DSLAM be extended to the smooth curved trajectory?
Okay. Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. So we have some results for some smooth trajectories. They are not as strong as the case in which we have piecewise linear trajectory. Okay. And I guess I'm not completely certain, but I guess it is really because when a trajectory is piecewise linear, you can think of the problem as seeing a projection of your, let's say, phenomenon on the trajectory. And that makes the, I don't know, geometry of the problem much more constrained rather than having, let's say, a smooth curve where, you know, thinking in terms of projections is more complicated. We have some results for smooth trajectories, but we have further constraints in that case, okay? So we can solve it, but we have to add further constraints. So the pulses need to be, for example, sufficiently separated. So it's probably not super satisfactory in terms of result. And I think there is definitely room for further work in that area.
Thank you. So there's maybe as a last question in the interest of time, we have the question, can you briefly talk about the latest optimizations over the minimal distortion under sub-Nyquist sampling with finite bit precision? I'm not sure this is also very technical.
Yeah, this is very technical. Yes, I'm not sure what optimization is referring to. Mm-hmm. I think only maybe one point I can make is that in our setting, we are not quantizing the timing information, okay? And so that's obviously an open question, okay? So what happens when you quantize the timing information, even if you have a fine quantization, which is what you would have in practice, whether, let's say, the uncertainty on the timing can have an effect on the way we do the reconstructions, okay? This is something we have not looked at. Maybe that's the only real thing I can mention, okay?
Okay, so thank you very much, Pierluigi, for this excellent talk in the One World Signal Processing Seminar Series. So this was actually our last talk of this fall edition. Thank you for attending all. And yeah, stay tuned on the One World Signal Processing website for next talks to come up. So thank you very much, Pierluigi. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you very much. Thanks very a nice. Lot. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye.